Now, before we go deeper into the subject, we might first define what we mean by extremism. Now, the philosopher Roger Scruton, in his Dictionary of Political Thought, defined extremism as, quote, a vague term which can mean, one, taking a political idea to its limits regarding of unfortunate repercussions, impracticalities, arguments, and feelings to the contrary, and with the intention not only to confront but also to eliminate opposition. Number two, intolerance towards all views other than one's own. And three, adoption of means to political ends which show disregard for the life, liberty, and human rights of others. So given that this is quite a broad term, and that often politicians and interest groups label their opponents or fringe opinions as extreme to vilify them, how do you separate a genuine threat to our liberties from a political from political rhetoric? So how do you recognize and define them? What does extremism mean to you? Examples, and what are your biggest concerns at the moment?
From theoretical perspective and from practical one, we have a lot of problems in Slovenia also, how to define extremism and how to differentiate, how to recognize the difference between the chauvinism, I would say, which is the on the bottom of the ladder, then we go higher. If you go higher, we can define then the extremism, or violent extremism, and on the top of the ladder, we can talk about terrorism. Actually, I participated in parliamentary commission, which is still seeking, I think, the solution how to define extremism. And I have to say that they are not very successful in finding the solution. And as I'm aware, the members of the parliament from the opposition side who participated in this this steering board commission resigned, so probably we will not get kind of valid definition of extremism. But nevertheless, we have very clear this definition of chauvinism or hate speech, so to speak, in our penal code. And that definition, I think, can be also defined from some perspective as a definition valid for extremism. We have probably in Slovenia a little bit different perception or misperception what is extremism or what do mainstream politicians do in the respect of political extremism that was tackled upon from the beginning. From the start on, it was our colleague mentioned Hungarian case, which is right extremism. What about the left one? What about Syriza, for example, in Greece, that is presented as also in this country as some kind of model of future democratic socialism kind of in seeking the solution, economic one, we are turning back to the history, to the bitter historical lessons that we had in the past. And I would say that Syriza or democratic socialism is not the right solution for Slovenia, for Greece, or for European Union. Because the migrations or migrants are one of the sources for extremism also in Europe. And one topic that I'm handling especially during my research, and I have to say it's very hard to talk about, even among the academians, let alone within the political community, is the question of, for example, Islamic radicalism. We are seeing that, for example, war in Syria is producing a huge numbers of extremists who are EU citizens, who are people of non-EU member states origin, but they are born in those countries. Germany is one of them, Belgium, France, and so on. And what is problematic with that? The numbers are getting higher and higher. And they are trained killers coming back home in countries as France and Great Britain. And they are posing a grave threat, I would say, to the national security. And the problem with that is that it's not only immediate threat from security perspective, but this opens also the question of multiculturalism or how our, I wouldn't say melting pot policy, but how our policies regarding the migrants are working within the European Union, especially if you look at the numbers. So we have around 20 million of our people living in European Union who are migrants, so around 4% of our population. More than 33 million are of foreign origin. There are around 6 or 7% of labor force within Europe, the migrants. And the questions that are arising from that, let me put it mildly, cultural non-integration into our societies are the ones that are not very popular with the mainstream politics. Therefore, we are seeing the rise of radicalization within the political spectrum, and the numbers are getting higher, especially on the right-hand side of that spectrum. They are coming from the parts of the world that are in, they are scarce of food, water, they are in the armed conflicts, and each year we get around 1.3 million of migrants into the European Union. We can see, or we are seeing pictures on televisions that are not very nice, what happened to some of them, what is happening to some of them during that process. But what is my point? And this is of course paradox for European Union. We need them, because our working force, the ratio between the people who are actually working and the ones who are retired, or they are not labor, not workforce, the ratio is going to be 1.3 in this year in Slovenia. EU average is 2 workers per 1 person who is retired. But if we look at the numbers in 1950s, this number was 7 versus 1. So we have 7 people who are working for 1 person who is retired. The migrants are helping us to sustain this welfare state that was described before. And on the other hand side, they are causing some kind of problems that I would say we don't have very good answer to solve them yet. Thank you.
What I would like to add, that I'm afraid of what's going to happen in, I don't know, 3, 5, 10 years. As we can see, there are a lot of young don't have a job. So I'm really afraid of what's going to happen. I don't know, for example, like 5 or 6 days ago, 2 girls from Vienna decided to go into the war, into Syria. So you can imagine what else could happen.
I would agree, I think, with my neighbor to the right, that there is also a problem of immigrant extremism, and you referred, I think, to what I would see from a Huntingtonian clash of civilizations perspective, because much of the immigration into the European Union is from the Muslim world, and this is a different civilization. And I would argue the first question which this raises is the institutional stability of our countries. According to those who have studied the rise of the West and who have done studies in comparative civilizations, the main reason why the West overcame mass poverty before other civilizations is the character of Western institutions. I cannot go into detail, but it's obvious that institutions are something like the rules of the game, and they work best if most people submit most of the time voluntarily to the rules of the game. And immigrants coming from a different civilization simply cannot know the rules of the game. And this means that there are some problems with mass immigration. And these problems get worse under 2 conditions. One is, if most immigrants come from the same society, and unfortunately most immigrants into Europe come from the Muslim world today, and are likely to come from either the Muslim world or from Africa tomorrow. If a significant number of them came from, let's say, East Asia, Latin America, and India, then the same number of immigrants would pose a smaller problem than if all of them come from the same sending society. Because if there is an Indian, a Brazilian, a Chinese, an Arab, and an African, if there are five peoples like these immigrating into Slovenia or into Germany, they are likely to learn the ways of the natives. If five of them come from the same village in Pakistan, or in Turkey, or in Algeria, they are more likely to establish a kind of parallel society. And this is an issue which our politicians have not yet understood. Chain migration, and this is a typical kind of migration which we observe, as such, makes integration more difficult. And the second way to make integration more difficult is if you have a welfare state. I do think that integration via labor markets is conceivable. Integration via receiving transfer payments is inconceivable. And one of the reasons why integration works better in the United States than in Europe is that the American welfare state is less generous. Our politicians are not ready to face any difficult issues. And so I'm tempted to say there is another kind of government extremism. Extremism in not using their brains. And this worries me much more than the extremism of young people who join Jobbik or the Front National or any other such group. So I really think that the word extremism is used too much by our politicians in order to turn our attention away from the main issues facing our societies.
Now, I want to touch on a subject that you all one point or another, I think, alluded to, which is the connection between the broader economic situation and extremism. So, for instance, Markus Brückner of National University of Singapore and Hans-Peter Grüner of University of Mannheim, when analyzing the connection between economic performance and political extremism, found the following. Our main finding is that higher per capita GDP growth is significantly negatively linked to the support for extreme political positions. While estimates vary between specifications, we find that roughly a 1% point decline in growth translates into a 1 percentage point higher vote share of right-wing or nationalist parties. Which, of course, seems to make sense when people can't find jobs or they become desperate and they will find comfort in any kind of political promise. So shouldn't we really, in this situation, when we find constantly empirical studies and economic theories support that economic freedom, the most economically free countries develop most prosperity, and therefore we can find in these kind of situations a lower possibility for extremists.